know about you, but I feel a little cooler after listening to that song. Good morning, everyone. My name is Stephen Parapelic, and Ella Crom and I are happy to be serving as today's worship associates. It's good to be with you this morning, whether in person or virtually. Welcome to your joy, your hope, your pride, as well as your grief, your fear, your anger, even parts of you that are not ready to be seen and heard. Thank you for joining us. We who strive to share teaching of hope and peace, we welcome all in our doors, the joyful, the heartbroken, atheists and Christians, Muslims and Jews, straight and gay, lesbian, bisexual, transgender, all who are searching, seeking, looking for more meaning, service, and love in their lives. Whether it's your first worship service with us or your many hundredth time, we hope that you'll discover questions that stretch you, people to befriend you, and liberal religious values that challenge you to join in loving boldly, living justly, and welcoming openly. Please join us after service for social hour, plus discussion in the parlor that will begin at 11:30 a.m. Parlor discussion can also be accessed over Zoom. The link is in the order of service, found on our website, and it will also be displayed on the screen for a few minutes at the conclusion of today's service. If you happen to be live streaming this morning, especially if you haven't done so before, please send us a quick note letting us know who you are, where you are live streaming from, and whatever else is on your mind. You can email us at checkingin@winchesteruu.org. But for those here in the sanctuary, let's turn towards the camera above the welcoming congregation banner and offer our greetings to those on the live stream. And now let's take a moment to greet one another in person.
Today's opening words come to us from the Reverend Dr. Sophia Betancourt, who is the newly elected president of the Unitarian Universalist Association. Unitarian Universalism has a vital, liberating message for our time. Our nation and denomination are experiencing challenges in a time of significant division, change, and radicalization. But together, we can serve one another, organize for justice, widen the circle of concern, collectively imagine new ways forward in community, and grow spiritually. May we look forward to the continued work of radical inclusion, faithful witness, and the embrace of a wide range of voices and leaders of our faith. I now invite Claire McNeil and Patty Shepherd, two of our delegates to this year's General Assembly, to kindle our chalice.
Something happens when we gather. Something happens when we gather in all the many ways that we now gather. So, in gratitude for the divine spark that dwells within each of us and circulates between, among, and all around us, we light this chalice. And now, please rise in body or in spirit to join in singing hymn number 360 in the gray hymnal, Here We Have Gathered.
Thank you. The service of the living tradition honors ministers and other religious professionals in different chapters of their ministries. We begin our time of centering with a prayer offered in this year's service by the Reverend Duncan Teague.
Here we have gathered together again. We ask that the spirit that flows through each of us, the spirit that connects us in beautiful ways, be with us even more. And we're so grateful for that spirit that has blessed us. Help us love in the most powerful, profound ways. Spirit that connects us all in ways that we don't like. The connections, the entanglements we are ashamed of, confused by because we want perfection. We want to be complete according to our understanding of everything we face. Everything and everyone who bothers us, who threatens us, and may have harmed us. Spirit, gently hold us. Make our hearts bigger. Love and touch the brokenness we carry. Take us to the place where we can heal, be healed, and heal others. Please take some of the pain. May we move more humbly and with steadfast regard for all those ancestors and mentors and ministers and educators and singers and pianists, and especially those that we couldn't stand. May our abilities and talents move us in the direction of being beloved and building the wonders we need to survive. May we be the mighty love to those who are seeking strong transformational love, justice, and acceptance. May we, all of us, bless each other gently, joyfully, in our efforts and our dreams. May we rest when it is our time to rest, knowing that we have done our best and have been the person we long to be, and have held close the love given us. Over and over and over and over and over and over again. Our most sincere gratitude, our curiosity, and our sorrow. Amen. Asante, which is Swahili for thank you, and Ashe.
At this time, you are invited to come forward, to light a candle, and to share a joy or sorrow that you carry within. Please note that because this service is being live streamed, it is available over the internet in the moment and as an archived recording. If anyone wishes to have a candle brought to them, please raise your hand. Reverend Heather will be lighting our first candle.
Thank you. I would like to light a candle in celebration of the life of Ian Dunhart, son of Patty Shepherd, brother to Shane Dunhart, who died recently. This symbol also represents the love that we have for Patty and Shane and all those who knew and loved Ian. I wish to light a second candle for all those impacted by the flooding in Vermont, and with today's rain, this crisis is only going to grow.
I'll light a candle in concern for the young person who yesterday drowned at the Mystic Lakes. And I will also light a candle for a celebration of my daughter who began a new job on Monday and loves it. Thanks be.
I'm also going to light a candle for the people of Vermont. My parents spent 25 years after they retired in Plymouth, Vermont, with the back of their property line on the Black River. And at some point I'll find out, you know, if their house is still there, but it may not be.
Good morning, I'm Tyson Kamikawa. We recently picked up a condo in P-Town. I've been spending a little time up there and made a bunch of new friends, street performers, and got acquainted with a very different way of living and performing, and so I'd just like to celebrate all of these street performers out there. Please tip them as generously as you can. They're all just trying to make it to the next day.
Hello, my name is Naomi Mignoni, and I would like to just have a moment to think about a friend of ours who has had Parkinson's for years, and she's now going through the end parts.
We now light one last candle for all the unspoken joys and sorrows. We will share a time of silence until the second hymn.
Good morning. I may be an odd duck, maybe even an old odd duck. I grew up in the 60s in a Universalist church in a town close by. This predates the merger of the Unitarian and the Universalist churches here in the United States. The Universalists practice what I would describe as a more Christian faith. We said the Lord's Prayer every Sunday, we had communion once a month, and two services ran simultaneously, one for the adults in the sanctuary and one for the children in the children's chapel. But there were also lots of similarities. We believed in nurturing and caring for each other and creating a community of volunteer service within and beyond the walls of the church. Meanwhile, there was also a Unitarian church in this same town. The only interaction we had was one combined youth group, Liberal Religious Youth, LRY. Much like our own WCG, we participated in trips and produced amazing worship services together. Following the merger while I was in college, it was decided to sell the Universalist Church, which had a smaller footprint and membership, and keep the Unitarian Church. Sadly for my family, it was also decided to keep the Unitarian minister and release the Universalist minister. So things looked very different for me when I returned home from college. However, all of this piqued my interest in learning more about our merged faith. This brings me to today's topic about General Assembly. And here's where the odd duck comes in. I have an affinity for systems, whether it's where you fit in the healthcare system, the care system for people with disabilities, and faith-based systems. As Unitarian Universalists, we have an amazing opportunity because we are part of a larger faith movement with diversity in faith practices while still embodying the same shared set of principles. We have UU churches today that continue to say the Lord's Prayer every week. The majority of these UU churches are members of the Unitarian Universalist Association of Congregations, or the UUA. Their offices are located right here in Boston, with member congregations from around the world. Each year, these congregations gather somewhere in the United States, and before Canada created its own Unitarian Council, we met in Canada. While we enjoy the intimacy of a close-knit community here, there is nothing more spectacular than singing your favorite hymn with thousands of voices, or hearing from acclaimed authors and public figures who influence social change, or attending workshops to learn more about programs that we might even be able to replicate in our own church, or representing your church as a delegate, voting on matters of the larger denomination. I began attending General Assembly as a delegate from my prior UU church. They supported me financially to attend in Salt Lake City in 1999. That's where the old part comes in. There I absorbed everything I could, whether it was workshops, or just being in Salt Lake City and the Mormon Tabernacle Choir. I found out there that you could actually volunteer at GA and have your entire registration paid for. That was magical for me because I could keep learning and keep developing spiritually and both give back to this faith that means so much to me and help people, because I volunteered with accessibility services, people with disabilities be included in faith practices. Up until this point, people with disabilities, and sadly to some extent still, are still a marginalized population within our society and within our faith. So for the next couple of years, I volunteered in accessibility services, and in 2002 became the coordinator. It became how I did GA, helping others access all aspects of this annual gathering of congregations, whether it was mobility and adaptive equipment, listening devices, accessible spaces in hotels and convention centers, and mobility orientation for those who are blind. The position has grown over the years from a volunteer position to a paid consultant. We have educated convention and hotel staff to what accessibility really means. But at its core, it remains steadfast to our UU principle of honoring the inherent worth and dignity of every human being. I encourage each of you to experience General Assembly. Next year, it will be virtual again. And in 2024, we'll gather in Baltimore, not very far away. Won't you please join me?
This morning's reading also comes from the service of the Living Tradition, entitled Pushing for Change by Alondria Williams, and it's read by her mother, Elnora.
The title of this reading is Pushing for Change. If we believe in the promise of our faith, we must continue pushing forward, even if the reality makes us want to give up. There is no one-size-fits-all solution or model, but there are many paths forward based on context, relationships, and place. Ideology sparks movements, but relationships are what change organizations and sustain movements. It takes one relationship at a time. In the end, changes to the leadership of the institution happen because of relationships people pushing. We must place value on the relationships and the need to not leave folks behind in our quest for transformation. I live in a small city, and living in that small city helps me understand what community means. Community doesn't only include the people who agree with you or those with whom you want to be friends. Our Unitarian Universalist faith is similar in the sense that we are a small religious community of people who are not bound by creed, but instead are bound by principles, values, and a covenant with a need for intellectual rigor combined with spiritual depth or humanist love. Everything comes back to our congregations and covenant communities. That is where the faith starts and ends. We must embody the changes we wish to see and not just say we believe in the changes. We must actually live the changes with every fabric of our being. If we believe in the promise of our faith, we must continue pushing forward.
City of Pittsburgh is a place where rivers converge. As a place surrounded by moving water, it is also a city defined by its bridges. This gathering place seemed like the perfect metaphor for General Assembly, like many waters in motion, originating from different places. For 1 week, we came together to meet and merge, forming a large yet temporary Unitarian Universalist community. And we were often in need of support and points of connection, bridges from one perspective to another. This is one thing that makes General Assembly exciting, being part of Unitarian Universalist community far from home. But I also found meaning in the reminders of our home here. There are those who remember whose presence remains through profound legacy. And then there are our current leaders who we are proud to call our own.
Those in need of accessibility services. Some of these challenges were inevitable. As the retirement of our longtime accessibility services consultant, Patty Cameron, has left us with a high bar to meet. Patty was here with us this week and I believe has left, but I would still like to publicly thank Patty for so many years of passionate and devoted service.
There is strength in who we've been, and there's strength in who we are. And the theme of this General Assembly was faithfully becoming, inviting us to think about how to grow into an uncertain future. There was a mural in the exhibit hall inviting passersby to step in front and imagine how they are faithfully becoming. Faithfully becoming speaks of movement, of transformation. Becoming speaks of change. The reality of our changing world and how we might grow amid these changes was the through line of General Assembly. Signs of the changing world around us appeared in unexpected ways. Perhaps the most profound was the recognition that the convention center was just a couple blocks from the courthouse where the shooter convicted of attacking attendees of the Tree of Life Synagogue awaited sentencing. We learned from local UUs that the Pittsburgh Jewish community was in its own time of spiritual discernment, with some survivors advocating for the death penalty and some seeking life imprisonment. Some people in Pittsburgh wore blue ribbons as a tangible symbol of witness to the grief and trauma of the local Jewish community. There are 2 days of programming for ministers before General Assembly begins. One tradition of ministry days is the Berry Street Lecture. This year's speaker was the Reverend Cecilia Kingman, a colleague who has dedicated much of her scholarship to understanding and resisting authoritarianism. It was hard to narrow down the clip to share with you today, but the following gives you a taste of Reverend Kingman's learning and message. One important point is that fascism is defined by tactics as much as by ideology. The cruelty is not only the point, but it's also a technique. Let's watch.
So this afternoon, I want to focus on recognizing and countering fascism without and within our faith. Fascism without seems pretty obvious. We all know that we are in a moment of grave danger. If anyone is left wondering how bad it is, it's very, very bad. It's alarmingly easy, however, for us to grow acclimated and numb unless we pay rigorous attention to the strategies and timelines used by fascists. We're also seeing a rise in fascist thinking within our own faith community. Not necessarily the political ideologies we associate with fascism, but the style of thinking. Please understand that I do not say this lightly. Unitarian Universalism is currently in a moment of major theological transformation and institutional reform. And this transition is causing a backlash within our congregations and among some of our own colleagues. We are moving away from individualism to communitarian values, from white supremacy culture to truly radical liberation, from a concentration of power among historically privileged groups and towards a new form of power sharing. And it is gorgeous. And some are responding to these shifts with anxiety and conflict. Some who are being asked to give up the primacy of their privilege and power are responding with tactics drawn from fascist politics. The 10th tactic is what Stanley, a child of Holocaust survivors, calls Arbeit macht frei, work shall make you free. His words were hung over the gates at Auschwitz. Fascists create an idea that minorities, immigrants, and others are lazy, that these groups need to be taught a work ethic. The mechanism they use is forced labor, whether it's prison labor or work requirements for benefits. The targeted groups must provide free labor as a supposed moral education. According to fascists, then, labor unions are supposedly run by communists who are trying to make things easier for lazy people. College students who protest conservative speakers are described as lazy, spoiled kids who need to get real jobs. The thing is, the end game in this calculation is evil. Valuing people by how hard they work means that the elderly, disabled, and even children can become disposable. The Nazis murdered these groups first because they believed that those who could not work had no value. Is it any wonder that we are now seeing the repeal of child labor laws in this time of rising fascism? Okay, that's Stanley's 10 tactics of fascism. Anybody need a cleansing breath? Now, it's not that each one of these makes a politician or a political movement fascist, but when these elements are present in number, and especially when people are told that they are under an existential threat from the created other, then that's fascism. And it is plain that in the United States, we are in the midst of an orchestrated takeover by fascist political groups. The legislative attacks of the last few months and the civil violence where domestic extremists act to create fear in targeted groups are all on the rise. Remember, fascism is inherently violent, and it begins with these seemingly random actors. But those domestic terrorists are part of the overall plan. Fascist politicians use stochastic terrorism, in which leaders use hate speech to incite seemingly random violence, because a terrified population is more easily controlled, and a terrified population will look for scapegoats. It is vital to understand that we are past the point of voting the fascists out. We have entered an era of violent civil conflict. Voter organizing is no longer a fully sufficient strategy, and we can't keep careening from one election cycle to another. We must work in coalitions to shape a multi-year plan for keeping these fascist politics in check.
Reverend Kingman's essay was not the only time during General Assembly when I found myself grieving. Another annual tradition is the Service of the Living tradition. This year it was led by staff and lay leaders from the Tennessee Valley Unitarian Universalist Church. For those who are unaware, Tennessee Valley suffered a mass shooting 15 years ago, the congregation targeted for its progressive and inclusive values. Two were killed and six injured in the attack. Worship led by survivors of the fascist violence Kingman spoke of earlier in the week was powerful. Today's reading, Pushing for Change by Alandria Williams, was read by E's mother, Elnora, as Williams, a former UUA co-moderator and renowned leader, died in 2020 at age 41. Her father and Elnora's husband, Irvin, died this past year. And the service of the living tradition is somewhat of an anniversary for me, as it was in this service 23 years ago that I first heard a call to the ministry. Now, quoting one of my colleagues, I recognize more of the people retiring or in memoriam than entering ministerial fellowship. So much change and loss. So where do we go from here? How might we grow into an uncertain future? This question was particularly pertinent this year, as this year was an election year. The UUA Presidential Search Committee invited more than one candidate to run, and only one said yes, the Reverend Dr. Sophia Betancourt. She previously held the presidency with Dr. Leon Spencer and the Reverend William Sinkford in an interim capacity for a brief time. Here is a clip from a presidential forum. I'll be sharing another clip at the post-worship discussion as our opening words.
Our second question for you is, how will you as president and the UUA that you will lead partner with our congregations and communities as we enter what is clearly a time of needing to either rebuild or reinvent or both our ministry, our congregational finances, and membership?
It's a great question. You know, I think that my primary answer to this relates really to all of the work we're doing together. We are in a reimagining and rebuilding moment, I think, on a lot of levels. When I think about the UUA, we talk a lot about the UUA as the institution that resources the promises that we make to one another, right? I would say, as a theologian, the UUA is an institution that holds close the covenant that we hold with each other, right, in community. That said, we're in a moment where risk-taking is central to figuring out new ways of being, and it worries me when I hear that either our communities or our congregations or like an individual board president or member or an individual religious professional is just having to risk on their own because we don't have the best practices shared together. My intention and my prayer is that the UUA will continue its powerful work to hold containers that allow us to share that risk together, right, so that more than one community is benefiting from something new. And what I would ask of you, you're gonna hear me ask things of you today, what I would ask of you is for grace. Risk requires the willingness to fail. Please let us fail with you, right, together, so that we hold that risk together, so we can find new ways to actually meet the needs of the day. So my commitment is to hold that innovation as the precious gift that it is, and to share our resources so we can do that risk together. And I would ask you, in the name of our fierce and fabulous UUA staff and our fierce and fabulous Board of Trustees, love us through failure so we can hold risk together. Thanks.
Indeed, we're not alone in needing to reimagine our approach to congregational life in the wake of so much cultural change and the impact of the pandemic. If you've been to General Assembly, then you know that it's almost guaranteed that at some point there'll be two events you really want to attend happening at the exact same time. For this reason, I missed the very popular Disrupt Church workshop led by leaders from Community Church in New York. Friends who attended the workshop provided some information, and I was able to view the workshop recording after GA. I will also be sharing some of this workshop in the after worship conversation. Perhaps the most important thing to take from this workshop is the understanding that we as a culture are in a tremendous shift. We used to be subjects and then became consumers. Now we are turning towards becoming engaged citizens. Many of our congregations are structured on a consumer model grounded in individualism and an exclusive identity. come to the after worship conversation and learn more. The theme of change also emerged as we considered how, as a collective body of Unitarian Universalists, we would communicate our commitments. One important part of General Assembly was engaging with Article 2. Article 2 is the part of the UUA bylaws that speak to our beliefs, currently expressed in our 7 principles. Like many other congregations, WUS has adopted an 8th principle. I will be exploring Article 2 through its own service at the end of August. For now, you should just know that the Assembly voted to continue the conversation and bring a revised document before the 2024 General Assembly for acceptance or rejection. Another important piece of business was a resolution to entirely divest the UUA's money from fossil fuel companies. At the risk of overly simplifying the issue, the general consensus among delegates was that we supported the idea, but the resolution proposed an unrealistic approach. The resolution was vocally supported by our youth and young adults, passionately speaking to their legitimate fear and anger about climate justice, leaving many of us, in the words of a colleague, torn between voting with our head and voting with our breaking heart. This particular plenary was difficult and contentious for many reasons. In the end, delegates voted against the resolution. UUA staff have voted to reconnect with youth and young adult leaders to articulate a different process that will bring us to our common ethical goal. UUA presidential candidate Sophia Betancourt received 95.5% affirmative votes, making her the next president of the Unitarian Universalist Association, the UUA's first Black, openly queer woman in the role. Let's watch this tender moment from her installation.
As we install you on this day, we offer you this gift of a stole, embroidered with the image of the breath of the spirit of life that moves through us and our world. May it root you in your connection to the holy. May it remind you of the calm vision you bring in the midst of winds and change. May it remind you of the trust we place in you, calling you to lead us.
In today's reading, we heard the late Alandria Williams' words, "We must embody the changes we wish to see and not just say that we believe in the changes. We must actually live the changes with every fabric of our being. If we believe in the promise of our faith, we must continue pushing forward." I close with words of encouragement from the Reverend Elizabeth Wynn, speaking to the courage needed to embody the changes we wish to see.
I'm a cis woman in my 30s with wavy black hair, half Vietnamese and half Irish German with gold earrings. I use she and her, and I'm here with a 1-month-old baby with a head full of black hair. This is Elena. She was born in April among daffodils and adventure. I've long felt the same way about being a parent as I have about psychedelics, intrigued by both, and like I could live a full and happy life without experiencing them. But also that there are realms of aliveness and being human that only those experiences could reveal. During her birth, there were times when I screamed over and over. I couldn't do it. My friend Reverend Annie Gonzalez and my husband, who were with me, told me that despite what I was saying, I was in fact doing it anyways. I was in fact giving birth to you. Giving birth to Elena. The courage I want to reflect on today is the courage to trust our collective values, our values of justice, compassion, liberation from systems of oppression, and profound interdependence, especially when we feel like we can't, especially when it feels too hard, too impossible. In the midst of giving birth, one part of my brain was very clear that I could not continue, could not do it. And even when that part took hold of me, there was another part that knew with unshakable certainty a love for this tiny life, a love that propelled me so that as much as I felt I couldn't, I also knew that I could and I would. Faith is another word for the courage to trust something that can feel so far away, so fleeting, so eclipsed by fear, doubt, and anxiety. Faith is another word for the courage to trust what can feel far away.
Our weekly offering is an opportunity of dedication, an invitation to live our values through acts of generosity. In this way, the offering is a spiritual practice, a collective affirmation of our shared values and commitment to the mission of this liberal religious congregation. There are several ways you can donate. Those in the sanctuary may give cash, checks, or donate electronically. Text to the number in your order of service or visit our webpage under the giving page. If you are visiting for the first time, either in person or online, you are a guest. In-person attendees can find a physical visitor card in the pew racks in front of you. Please complete it and put it in the collection plate. Information about how to give online and how to complete the virtual visitor card will soon be shared with the live stream attendees. The offering will now be generously given and gratefully received.
Those who wish to do so are invited to join in the unison affirmation. We gather not for ourselves alone, but to use our common power to build the beloved community within and beyond these walls. We create and reaffirm this covenant this day to make justice flourish, to practice compassion amidst difference, and to embody transformative love. Please rise in body or in spirit to join in singing hymn number 145 in the gray hymnal As Tranquil Streams.
Please be seated for the benediction. Our closing words come to us from the Reverend Nancy McDonald Ladd from the closing of the Sunday morning GA worship service.
If indeed we are to join among the people that this world needs, what is it we must actually be open to? What is it that we together must be willing to help create? Even in the crowded company of our greatest fears, open and willing to create hope where there was no hope before, amid the kindness of strangers and the care of our community. Through the winds that blow, shifting the sand beneath us that we mistook too often for solid ground, open and willing to be changed. Held by a tradition whose greater purpose remains undimmed, gifted with the wisdom that arises in the dark of night, open and willing to carry forward the work of progressive faith for the generation stretching out before us, accompanied by each other, yes, even when it is hard, accompanied by these friends and these collaborators across the tradition that is ours to share open and willing to make space for each other with graciousness and with goodwill. What are you, like you and you and you and you, open and willing to embrace, not just in this convention center or this worship service, but in the stretching span of your life of service? I invite you to think on that question, like really, right now. What new and aspirational thing are you open and willing to embrace in your life? I am not here to boss you around and tell you what that thing should be, but I am here to tell you, though it is not my business exactly what you commit to, you are called to be braver and more open. There is something in your soul right now waiting for a renewed commitment only you can make. Turn it over in your heart for a moment
hold it, this thing that is worth saying yes to. And when I raise my hand, when I raise my hands up in just a moment, I want to invite us to say together, here in this space and right where you are at home, to say together simply this: I am open and I am willing. Loudly or quietly, or in the silent sanctuary of your heart, let's say it together one time: I am open and I am willing. Amen. 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 Thank you.
Please read together the words for extinguishing the chalice. We extinguish this flame, but not the light of truth, the warmth of community, or the fire of commitment. These we carry in our hearts until we are together again. The service has ended, but our life of service continues. Let's continue this conversation at social hour and then gather in the parlor at 11:30 for a discussion about the service.